formation. But let me start first with gravitational waves, because gravitational waves is kindergarten exercise. And I will tell you what will be the difference for the scalar perturbation, which in fact we need to form the galaxy. Now, as I said, if you will want to consider small deviation from the Friedmann universe, you have to take metric in the following form. So 1 plus 2 phi, where phi, you can think that it's gravitational potential, d eta squared minus 1 minus 2 phi delta ik dxi dxk, so it's special coordinate, plus you add here transverse traceless path of the three-dimensional component of the metric perturbation, dxi dxk, and it's all. What we need, in fact, it's after so-called convenient gauge fixing, but you can do everything in terms of gauge invariant variables. Then we need to quantize this theory. As I said, you do it very easily. Put heads here. And here, of course, nothing would exist if there would be no perturbation of the matter. But what we will do, we slightly also disturb energy density. So it's background energy density plus delta epsilon. And also, you can introduce in for ideal hydrodynamical fluid, if you don't consider so-called vector perturbation, you can introduce the potential for the velocities. Now, here, to quantize this thing, you put head here, 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 and here, and it's all. Now, let me start with gravitational wave. As I described last time, if you will take and quantize gravitational waves, and because of the uncertainty relation, for instance, in Minkowski space, you are getting the following spectra. So here is amplitude, typical amplitude in the scale lambda, for instance, multiplied by k cube, where k is wave number, okay, take square root of this quantity, and then ask the question how it depends on the scale lambda, the physical wavelengths. And then, because there are no other parameters, here, at the Planck scale, L Planck, you have amplitude of the gravity wave 1, and then it drops down linearly. So, you know that this H lambda, let's denote it like this one, H lambda is equal approximately 1 over L. Everything is in Planck units, okay, not to confuse you. So now, clearly in Minkowski space, nothing will be happening, and this vector, spectra of the quantum fluctuations will stay invariant, right? Now, what will happen with this spectra, or how actually I could see this picture, if I would try to describe this Minkowski space using expanding coordinate, like Milne coordinate? Then it's clear that in this Milne coordinate, again, I can decompose all perturbation in Fourier modes. But then what will happen with physical wavelengths of each Fourier mode? It will be growing proportional scale factor divided by the given wave number. And then so-called pseudo-evolution will look like this one. You start with the given k, then universe is expanding. Okay, therefore, physical wavelength is growing proportional to the scale factor, but simultaneously, HIK, okay, is decaying inversely proportional to scale factor. Then this perturbation will move here. The perturbation from here will move here somewhere, and the spectra will stay invariant. So this is so-called evolution, but as I said, evolution which is not real evolution, just coordinate effect. Now, if now you go in curved space-time with non-zero curvature, then equation for the gravity wave is changing. I wrote this last time, so it will be like this one. Let me skip indices just to save time, okay? It's okay. Plus 2a prime over a, h minus Laplace h, Laplace with respect to Camusian coordinate is equal to zero. Then you can rewrite this equation, which looks like harmonic oscillator with friction, in the form which is close, more close to harmonic oscillator, just removing this term. If you will introduce variable u, which is, u which is h multiplied by a, by scale factor. So h is u divided by a, and also you consider, of course, here exponent ikx, plane waves. Then this equation for u will start to look like this one for each mode, plus k squared minus a2 prime over a uk is equal to zero. And then you understand that there is actually scale here, which dramatically changes the behavior of perturbation. And what is this scale? This scale is determined by condition that this term is equal to this term. And I said this condition is, because here we have second derivative, is k eta is equal to zero. Now, Then, if you divide this thing by a and multiply this thing by a, then what is this? It's 1 over lambda physical. And eta multiplied by a, as you see from metric element, is nothing more than just time, t, or you can say that it's inverse Hubble constant. Right? And then you understand that this condition, when perturbation dramatically changes their behavior, correspond to lambda physical is equal h minus 1. This is so-called curvature scale or the size of Einstein elevator, which you can introduce, in the curved universe. Also, now here you are forced to use expanding coordinate system. If you would be interested in the scale smaller than h minus 1, then you can still survive with Minkowski coordinate system, but on the scale h minus 1, larger than h minus 1, you cannot introduce Minkowski system. And therefore, here it's better to work in expanding coordinates. In spite of the fact that, of course, you can do everything first in non-expanding, then match it with expanding, but why we have to have headache if we can avoid it, right? And clearly that for perturbation with physical wavelengths smaller or much smaller than Hubble scale, the behavior of h, like it was before, it's 1 over a exponent e k eta, where eta is physical time. So they behave like in Minkowski space, and it's clear why, because curvature is irrelevant. Therefore, let's put this scale h minus 1 here, and let's see what will happen with this perturbation. Nothing. Okay, they will be going from here to here, from here to here, preserving Minkowski spectra. Now, in the space with curvature also, you do not know how to define vacuum fluctuations for this, for minimum fluctuations at the scale that larger than h minus 1. Here, you know in the leading approximation what you have for the vacuum fluctuation. Here, you have no idea, therefore, let's draw spectra like this one. Doesn't matter. Anyway, actually, it will disappear. Now, start with this perturbation and trace its evolution. Up to here, evolution clear, spectra is preserved. But when you cross the scale lambda physical is equal h minus 1, then for lambda physical larger than h minus 1, solution, leading solution, there are two modes. One is decaying anyway, therefore I will forget for it. But leading solution you can see immediately from this equation. Is just h equal constant, because there is first derivative here. So h is equal constant. Now, let's consider universe, which is not decelerating, but accelerating universe. And moreover, let's consider universe where we have cosmological constant. Then, what is dependence of h on time? A dot over a. It's exponent, exponential function, exponent, okay, derivative of exponent divided by exponent is just constant. Therefore, in the sitter universe, precisely the sitter universe, this scale is not changing with time. Now, what happens with perturbation after it crosses this scale? It starts to have constant amplitude, you see? And then, okay, like this one, when we are moving, like this one. And amplitude is always the same. And this amplitude h is nothing more than just 1 divided by scale, or it's h. At the moment of so-called horizon crossing, when k is equal to ha, the same condition, which I wrote before, just rewritten a little bit. But because here h is constant, doesn't matter this index. Then next perturbation comes after this. Next wavelength comes after this wavelength. Okay, trace like this one. Again, it leaves the curvature scale with the same amplitude, and then it's stretched. Okay, and this part of the spectrum where I don't know anything is moved somewhere here. Because it already, okay, was outside horizon, therefore its amplitude is preserved. What kind of spectra I am getting as a result? I am getting spectra where h is given by this quantity and doesn't depend on scale. You see, so this is so-called Harrison-Zeldovich spectra. If I will wait infinitely long, then this garbage will go away to infinity, and the spectra which I get will be precisely like this one. And this is why, for instance, in expanding universe, the spectra is always converging to what people called Bunch-Davis state. What they mean under Bunch-Davis state? Normally scalar field with mass minimally coupled, because in this case, because of the mass, positive mass squared, spectra is infrared convergent. Here you have infrared divergence if you wait for very infinitely long time. But nevertheless, this infrared divergence is not even dangerous because there are no term like h squared. They always come, even in correction to the Einstein equations, with derivative. There are people who try to explain cosmological constant using this infrared divergence. I think they have no reason to do it. Okay, now. Now let's look more realistic case. More realistic case when you have deviation from the cosmological constant. And in fact, you have to have these deviations because you want finally to have graceful exit, and you shouldn't forget, as I said before, that only by the breaking, the Devin configuration can be perfected, right? So, therefore, we will assume that P plus epsilon divided by epsilon is much smaller than 1, but nevertheless is not equal to 0. Then, if P plus epsilon is not equal to 0, then what happens with H? H is the energy density, or H squared is the energy density, and it's proportional, or better to say, H dot. There is one Friedmann equation which tells us that h dot is proportional minus epsilon plus p. If this quantity is positive, then clearly h is decreasing. Therefore, this scale, when this perturbation with this color would arrive here to the horizon crossing, h would change but just a little bit. Exponential factor grows, I mean, scale factor grows exponentially, but h just changes by the factor of logarithm of this growth. And the next perturbation, when it will arrive here, it will have slightly smaller amplitude. It will be transferred here, okay, with slightly smaller amplitude. Therefore, as a result, if you will make this kind of cartoon more carefully, you will get the spectra, which will be slightly growing towards to the large scales. This is inevitable condition if, for instance, this epsilon plus p is larger than zero. Clearly, h is changing by factor 2. Scale is changing by exponent. So what kind of spectra you could expect even without going to the particular scenario? Some logarithmic spectra which depends on the scale. And it's all. Now, of course, you can change epsilon just a little bit, so you can make energy density, as you will see, practically constant. Therefore, for gravity wave, you still can get, in principle, spectra which is not very different from so-called Harrison-Zeldovich spectra. But now let's go to more interesting case. Let's go to the scalar perturbation, where, in principle, if I want to quantize them, I have to make some kind of working distinction from here. And I'm not going to present you the details of the work. I just will find the right final result for the equation which describes scalar perturbation. Here we have this equation for the gravity wave. For scalar perturbation, you introduce some kind of variable v, which is called canonical quantization variable, and which is built, again, forget about coefficient, numerical coefficient, from the potential of the velocity, peculiar velocities, plus some coefficient, square root of 1 plus w, where w is pressure over energy density, so 1 plus w is epsilon plus p divided by epsilon, and gravitational potential. And in this case, this equation, which is similar to equation for u, is modified a little bit, and it looks like this one, v2 prime, again for the Fourier mode, plus k squared minus z2 prime over z, v is equal to 0, where z now is not scale factor, where z is equal scale factor multiplied by square root of 1 plus p over epsilon, or a multiplied by square root of 1 plus w. Now you see immediately that if you are in exactly the Sitter universe, treatment of the gravity wave makes sense, perfect sense, because gravity wave depends on the curvature, but scalar perturbation depends on the property of the matter, you see? And if you would take pure the Sitter, you would get nonsense, 0 divided by 0. So it doesn't make any sense. Therefore, again, you need to spoil this exact the Sitter invariance if finally you want to use the Sitter for any, or quasi the Sitter, better to say, for any practical purposes. Now, if you make here calculation now with quantizing this equation, etc., then what is the result which you will get for so-called scalar perturbations, which are generated in the course of this accelerated expansion? The result for h squared lambda for gravity wave was, again, up to coefficient of the order of 1, h squared taken at the moment when given wavelengths crosses the Hubble scale. This is lambda physical is equal h minus 1. Or if you recall to yourself first Einstein equation, which tells us, not Einstein, Friedman equation, which tells us h squared is equal energy density, again up to the coefficient, you will get that amplitude of gravity wave, or better to say even the spectra, is determined by energy density taken for each wave number, taken at the moment of Hubble scale crossing. You can call it horizon crossing, but you have to keep in mind that Hubble scale, which is really dynamical scale in distinction from all this event and particle horizon, Hubble scale, okay, in this case, coincide with event horizon, if you are in accelerating universe. So now how this formula will be modified after inflation, I will write you. Yeah, after the things are over, for the case of, which correspond to K, for the case when you have Newtonian gravitational potential. It will be very, everything is in Planck unit, so Planck density is equal 1. 1 plus W, where W is P over epsilon, again, deviation, 1 plus W deviation from exact de theta estimated at the moment k is equal ha. Now, if you will consider realistic models again whatsoever, then from this formula, it will follow that gravitational potential as a function of the scale should be proportional to logarithm squared to logarithm in sum of wave number in some power gamma, which depends on the inflationary model. In fact, actually, first time we got this spectra in 81 together with Chibisov, yeah, and it was here logarithm squared. Now, within observable range of the wavelengths, this logarithm can be well approximated by its first derivative, so you could write this thing proportional lambda in power 1 minus ns, and it's where we are measuring it in the scale which correspond actually to the time 50 folds before inflation ended. And then from this 50 number, okay, you can calculate what is this ns. Ns is 0.96. So this was the result of my paper with Chibisov from 81. Until today, I saw that we were the first guy who wrote it first on this planet, but after Gary Tok, I started to doubt maybe in Cambridge somebody wrote it in 17th century. But at least in this century, it was not written by anybody else. Now, so this is the result, and now we could ask question, how generic this result? If W is constant, you get power. But V is W equal constant, you will never finish inflation, as you know. Okay. It's if eternal. Then, time, yes.
For a long time, it's
constant. Right. Yes.
Really
absolutely. If you will change after that the slope, okay, then you can get power, but very small power. Again, it's proportional to 1 plus W. Now, okay, now. You know, in principle, that there are thousands of inflationary scenarios, of course, right?
Where is the 0.96 coming from?
From 150, as you will see, because, okay, yeah, well, from 50, it falls before the end of the inflation, because, of course, you cannot build 0.04 out of nothing.
It's 2 divided by 50.
It's 2 divided by 50, precisely. 50 e folds, 2 divided by 50, and I will show you why this result is very generic, because right now we have 1,000 scenarios. Okay, people are claiming that they are more successful in explaining something, but what I can tell you, of course, it's not big deal what people are doing. Why? Because everything what we measure, because we have measurement range for e folds between 50 and 55, right? Very small. In fact, it's 1 point. And then everything what people are doing with inflationary potentials, as I said here already once in the exercises, then for certain things they know value of the potential, some combination, as I say, combination of first and second derivative here. And after that, what about all these thousands of papers to take this function with the right derivative and then, okay, draw something like this one. And then on the top of this draw, they actually put 50 pages of blah, blah, blah to justify the irrelevant part of the potential. It's on internet, только, but it's too late anyway. So, now, I don't care, honestly speaking, but, okay, let's go further, because there is, of course, much better way of parameterizing the whole story here than with these potentials where you never know what is relevant, what is irrelevant. And by accident, by the way, I found this way 2 weeks before Planck release last year. And this way is the following. You, of course, can try P of epsilon. But then what you are getting nightmare, because you are getting some kind of non-analytical functions, et cetera, et cetera. And the best way, which I found to parameterize the whole thing, is this deviation of the equation of state as a function of the number of e-fold till the end of the inflation. Let me explain you. it's clear that if you want to have long enough inflation, you have to start with epsilon plus p over epsilon much smaller than 1. And then during 74, at least 74, this quantity should become of the order of 1. So 1 plus w should become of the order of 1, of unity. Now, let's say that what we want to do, we want to specify this ratio 1 plus w as a function of the number of e-folds till the end of the inflation. Yes? What is the number of e-folds till the end of the inflation? Write scale factor as equal scale factor at the end of the inflation multiplied by exponent minus n. And I want to use this parameter. Clear that when n is equal 1, inflation should be over. So if I will put here function n, I will put here 1 plus w, then it's clear that at n equal 1, the quantity 1 plus w should be of the order of unity, right? N equal to 0 or 1, okay, so let me skip this difference between 1 and 0 because I don't want to write in all the formulas, yeah. Right, then at very large n, 1 plus w should approach 0 because it should be much smaller than 1. Now, the range which is relevant for our observation, each has a small range between 50 and 55 folds, you see? Now, what kind of function could you draw here, which are epsilon plus 1 much smaller than 1, and which approach 0? Okay, we can make tests, of course, but we have no time for that. All reasonable people will draw something like this one, right? But, of course, we can find people who would like to draw the things like this one. I am sure that there will be even people who will take this function differentiable, completely non-differentiable. For instance, equal 1 in rational point and 0 in irrational point. I cannot cover all these possibilities, and also you understand that things should be smooth, right? And then the only option, which are more or less reasonable, which I found, some coefficient beta, which should be of the order of 1, divided by n in power alpha. And if you want really to cover 1,000 scenarios, I recommend you also to keep here logarithm gamma. Now, I'm not kidding, by the way. Of course, you can take this dependence now and map on all possible potentials, which people were describing in the literature. Moreover, recently there was published Encyclopedia of Inflationary Scenarios in the Institute of Astrophysics. You see, French like encyclopedias. It's, I think, about, I forgot how many, 200 most reasonable scenarios they have considered, but there are thousands, okay? The main difference between which is the name, because people became very sophisticated in naming, and even we, Steve, we contributed to philology, we invented this K-inflation, right? So now, then if you will take alpha equal 1, then it covers all power law potential, find power n. For instance, 3 beta correspond equal 1, correspond to phi squared potential, 3 beta equal 2 correspond to phi fourth potential, etc., etc., etc. Now, if you will take alpha equal 2, and don't care even about beta, then you will get R squared or Starobinsky inflation, you will get Higgs inflation, you will get a lot of string inflations, and I ask student to make classification of these scenarios with alpha and beta. And then whole class of scenarios was covered mostly by this n alpha and gamma in the relevant logarithm, as you understand, which doesn't change so much. Therefore, I think it's the best encyclopedia when you think just about these numbers. I know that these kind of things, media needs fundamental justification, but unfortunately, I'm sorry, I don't have one, and I do not take seriously what people call fundamental justification, which follows when you wrap 3 brains together with the other 5s, yeah? So, now, Okay, let's forget for a minute about this logarithm, because logarithm does change result. And let's come to some let's make some kind of statement on the basis of the formulas which I wrote. Take this formula for adiabatic perturbations. Then you can define what people call spectral index, which is d phi lambda squared over d lambda, I guess. And if you will make little calculations, then you will get that this thing is equal minus 3, 1 plus w, and then plus d over dn logarithm 1 plus w. And the whole thing, of course, this derivative depends on lambda. The thing should be estimated at the moment of time n, lambda, which correspond to horizon crossing. Now, this term is negative. You see, because 1 plus w is positive. This term also should be negative if I will assume the deviation of the equation of state from cosmological constant grows towards the end of the inflation. And shouldn't forget that actually we are considering very small interval, just 50 e-folds really. Therefore, if you will take now this kind of factorization, you will get immediately that ns minus 1 should be equal minus 3 beta divided by n in power alpha, and from logarithm, what we will get from logarithm, we will get minus 2 divided by n in power alpha. Then, for the given n, where we measure it, which is 50, keeping in mind that beta is of the order of unity, you could consider now this function ns minus 1, or better to write 1 minus ns, as a function of all this alpha. And then you will find that it's like this one, and ns minus 1 is always different from 0. So ns, you can, if you play with these numbers, you will find that anyway ns is smaller or equal than 0.97. And this is very natural thing, because this kind of logarithmic deviation of the spectra, from the flat spectra, just reflects physics, that you have to finish inflation. You see? And I recall that in 2003, where it was? In fact, there was Nobel Symposium, yeah? Where David and Mike Turner had full of the questions that I put on the board, that what is more important to measure, this logarithmic spectra, logarithmic deviation, or deviation omega from equal 1. And everybody voted against me. The only guy who told me that he voted for me was Starobinsky, but I didn't see his hand, in fact, maybe secretly. And but Lyman Page, who was in auditorium, he is more reasonable and do not trust theories too much. Yeah? So therefore, okay, a few months later, I got from him message, look, we are preparing small-scale experiment like Atacama, and if I would find that spectral index is 0.99, yeah, would you give up on inflation? I wrote to him, no problem, okay, if you will find that it's plus minus 0.01 as a level of 3 sigma. Then at the level of 3 sigma, I am giving up, no, 6 sigma even, with this inflation, because, of course, there would be people who would find immediately explanation for this thing. And by the way, I can do it myself even 1,000 times better than most of these people, because actually I think the largest number of ugly scenarios I invented also. But look, even in the paper of 92 in this physics report, there is a whole chapter about these ugly scenarios, but it's written at the end that the value of this thing is just exercise, because theory becomes unpredictable. The only theory with the minimal number of parameters, yeah, which predicts more that you put inside, is valuable. The rest, Okay, everybody can do. And this thing can do only nature, because I have to recall you that Landau was normally telling, give me two free parameters, I will fit you any experimental curve. Okay, with three free parameters, you don't need to be Landau even to do this thing, right? Now, let's summarize what I said. Okay, so inflation, as follows from here, has very robust predictions, and they are all independent and non-trivial. First, robust prediction, there was stage of accelerated expansion, or cyclic universe with very large even period of time of life, then omega should be equal 1, flat geometry. This prediction, I cannot recall who wrote it in the paper. Everybody was discussing it in couloirs in 81, but nobody has courage to write it in the paper. You know why? Because if people would write it in the paper, then astronomers would tell immediately, your omega, your theory is ruled out. Yeah? No way, because I recall that before these kind of things, I heard talk of Wheeler, who was speaking about closed and, and flat universe. I thought that guy perhaps is a little bit detached from reality. Therefore, this was extremely non-trivial prediction. I don't know who did it first, but people realized it immediately because it's, as I explained, kindergarten exercise, yeah, to get it. Now, second prediction, because I am considering one fluid to be responsible for both cosmic acceleration and perturbation. From here, it immediately follows that produced perturbation should be adiabatic. What does it mean, adiabatic? After this fluid will decay, producing us cold dark matter particles, baryons, and photons, it means that the ratio of photons to concentration of photons to concentration of cold dark matter particles should be precisely constant, in spite of the fact that the amount of photons can vary from place to place. The amount of baryons can vary from place to place, but the ratio should be everywhere exactly the same. You could imagine also that you distributed baryons inhomogeneously on homogeneous background of radiation. Then, because you know that entropy is number of photons per baryon, you would have variation of entropy, and these perturbations are called entropy perturbations. Non-trivial prediction, which was in contradiction with all astrophysical observations in 80, but because the quality of all these astrophysical observations was so-so, you could forget about it. Third prediction, you see what we did. We took Einstein equations and linearized them in the homogeneous background for perturbation. Then what we got? We got harmonic oscillator. Then what we did? We took harmonic oscillator in ground state, where it was Gaussian thing, and so-called excited it. Made very large occupation numbers, because if you will take for this constant spectral occupation number, doesn't matter how you will define them, for big scale it will be at the level of 1050, you see, so classical stuff, obviously. Then the fact that you got everything exciting harmonic oscillator by external classical force means that your field phi is the random Gaussian field, so it's characterized entirely by two-point correlation functions. But we know, on the other hand, that Einstein equations are nonlinear. Therefore, you could always calculate nonlinear corrections, which would spoil this Gaussian distribution. And on the dimensional ground, you naturally expect that this correction will be of the order of phi squared multiplied by some coefficient, FNL, which people call this non-Gaussianity parameter. You see, when you say Gaussian, everything is clear. When you say non-Gaussian, nobody knows what is this, because it's everything what is non-Gaussian. You see, this is definition. Now, but here you have concrete type of non-Gaussianity, and with the coefficient FNL, which you expect on the generic ground, which should be of the order of unity. You see, because from where contribution can come? From many terms in Einstein equation, quadratic correction, but normally, for instance, in slower roll regime, you do not even generate. Therefore, for instance, how much non-Gaussianity can be generated in our universe, mostly on subsequent evolution, when perturbation becomes sound waves, people are getting 2 or 3 for FNL, but for sure not 40 and not 50. Again, this is non-trivial prediction. In 1980, everything was in contradiction with it, because in 1980, the most popular theory of galaxy formation was Peebles' theory of entropy perturbations. Everybody who worked on this adiabatic theory lived only in one country. You can guess in which. Because it was in complete contradiction with all CMB observations. Because, okay, people never used omega equal 1. They didn't suspect that there is also dark matter, etc., etc., etc. And there was not so good data on abundance of deuterium at this time. In the 80s, together with this theory also appeared the theory which is called cosmic strings, which were dominating and very popular. In 89, to make situation worse or better for us, right now it's better for us, Neil Turek invented textures. You see, and okay, the claim was that textures perfectly describe this world and you have forget about everything. Now, what happened with these series, I will tell you later. But they were dominating really until 2000, and people were not taking care about adiabatic perturbation. Fourth prediction, as I said, is prediction for the spectral index, ns minus 1, ns, yeah? So, phi lambda is proportional to logarithm lambda in some power, or okay, some power here, or lambda in power 1 minus ns. It's very non-trivial thing, as you understand, because it means that the amplitude of perturbation logarithmically grows towards the larger scale. And if, for the flat spectra, you could use some kind of blah-blah-blah argument, like two of my friends were doing using this holographic principle, yeah, here there is no any explanation for this logarithmic dependence besides of the theory which was developed. And finally, prediction number 5 and ns. By the way, these 3 predictions are mine prediction with Chibisov. Yeah, in 81, because some people have not so good memory, what can I do? So, actually, all of them were in the paper, 81, before even, I think, word inflation appeared in the Nature. And finally, 5th prediction is prediction of the gravitational wave, which is characterized by ratio of tensor to scalar perturbation, okay, and I will write you exact thing just to compare, and which is nothing more than just 24, 1 plus W in the appropriate scales. Now, this is Starobinsky result, not in this form, but for gravity wave from 1979. In 1980, he even wrote that if there was this stage, you could see it measuring this gravity wave. Now, what was going on? Okay, let me tell. These things are generated precisely after inflation. And after that, for very long time, I even don't have enough blackboard to show you how long is this time. Yeah? From the moment of time (10⁻³⁵ s) towards the moment of time about 100,000 years, nothing happens with this perturbation in any relevant scales for observation. Why? Because during this time, the size of these perturbations which were generated in this accelerated stage is much larger than C multiplied by T. Just because of causality, you cannot do anything with these perturbations because using some kind of microscopic processes. Irrespective of what happens with particle physics, you see, you are on the safe side. When people derive some kind of evolution of the gravitational potential depending on the change of the equation state, it's also somehow gauge artifact. Everything is frozen. So you could think that seeds of the galaxies were produced at this moment of time, then were put in refrigerator for 100,000 years. But when universe became 100,000 years, this perturbation started to enter horizon. And of course, it's radiation, cold dark matter, and baryon plasma. And what you do, they start to oscillate. Before that, they were not oscillating, yeah, like waves. But then, when the frequency of oscillation, roughly speaking, or inverse frequency becomes smaller than cosmological time, they start to oscillate and become sound waves. And standing sound waves, why? Because, as you understand, universe is homogeneous and isotropic, therefore, for each k, there is minus k perturbation which is produced. As a result, this nice logarithmic spectrum, which was before, is deformed. In the, for the long wave perturbation, which didn't tend the horizon, it remains the same. But for small scale perturbation, it becomes like this one. There is the cut here, because at this time, when universe is 100,000 years old, viscosity terms already are important. There is actually this not complete modulation because the perturbation after entering the horizon becomes generate entropic component with respect to cold dark matter particles which get chance to move with respect still coupled baryon radiation plasma. You see, so, but these kind of calculations are based on very reliable plasma physics together with general relativity, by the way, because everything here is general relativity, strong general relativity effect, because you cannot present evolution of Friedman universe like Minkowski space plus small deviation, as you know. And then when you do this kind of calculations, also you are involving GR, namely the evolution of the curve. Then, as I said, after generating this kind of spectra is the distribution of the energy density, radiation decouples when universe was about 400,000 years old. Now, 400,000 years old. And then light starts to propagate and delivers this, us this nice picture, yeah, of the what we see on the sky, which is very good picture, and perhaps I have to remind you a few curves, because one thing is if I will draw it here, the other thing if you will see them. Maybe we don't need actually this screen, because these two screens are enough, but I want to connect my computer. But with what? Ah, okay, here is something, and
you didn't mention reheating.
Reheating, not relevant. Reheating actually is relevant just to telling us n, which we see, is 50, 52, 53, etc. But, because we don't know precisely equation of state at this time. But it's within arrow bars of the cosmic microwave background fluctuations, and I want to show you this thing with some other purpose, to tell the range of reasonability, where we should still go there, yeah, with all this thing. Okay, so is there or not yet? Not yet. Ah, but I don't need actually this projector. If it's here, then it's fine. Or it works only in combination. Or they are entangled.
The screen on the side is not immediate.
Ah, the screen on the side is not immediate. Okay. So now, what you do? Okay, not to lose time. You take this as prediction, you take this as prediction, you take this as prediction, you take this as prediction. Forget for a minute about this thing. Why? Because gravity wave anyway do not influence curves at L larger than 80. You see, because they decay very much. And then, what you do also? You can take H0 parameter from measuring supernova, right? Then you can take omega baryon from measuring deuterium abundance. You can take cosmological constant, yeah, from supernova, otherwise it's not clear what for they got Nobel Prize, right? And then if, for instance, there would be no of these optical depths, you could take even amplitude from baryon acoustic oscillation. And then with these four predictions, plus astrophysical parameters, you have curve which have no free parameters at all. No free parameters. Of course, it's not so good accuracy, but no free parameter, or if you forget about this optical depth, then one free parameter, which is amplitude. And then, why it takes even longer than... So it will come finally or not? Or I have to start... No, now one is dark, the other still functioning. About what? About doing this thing. No, okay, then everybody can open computer and find curve on the internet. And I can. No, I connected everything. So I just can restart computer maybe. I just don't know. No, but it's nothing is coming, yeah. Let's do once more. You see, it doesn't react even.
Yeah, I know.
No, okay, you try and I will continue to talk, yeah? It's okay. So let me write what actually this data confirmed. Okay, first of all, of course, some people were dreaming to find omega a little bit smaller than 1 by 1%. But now omega is equal 1. So this is experiment with accuracy plus minus 0.005. 5 is the last number. In the previous release, it was 0.06. So this omega accuracy didn't improve too much, even with this last release, which will be available at the end of January. Now, so everything is okay, I guess. We can sleep here very well. Now, adiabatic perturbation, because there appeared a lot of papers with admixture of cosmic string, etc., etc., etc. Now, after Planck, less than 1% and in some multiple much less than 1% of any admixture to adiabatic perturbation. So you see, perturbations are adiabatic with accuracy 99% at least, beta. So one test passed, second test passed, third test, Gaussianity. 2 weeks before Planck release, last year, there were spreaded a lot of rumors all around the world. And there was even conference for 3 months in Santa Barbara, which was supposed to discuss non-Gaussianity. Because everybody, I mean, crowd of young people who have something to do also, were hoping that people will find non-Gaussianity. And after that, we will be making ugly models. yeah, with the help of it, and the rumor which was spread that FNL which Planck sees is 40 plus minus, I forgot already. We had even an Garkin conference with 160 people, by the way, third of whom knew the result, but nevertheless they were keeping silence. It's the only case, perhaps, on the Earth when team, if I forget about the Swiss, when team are consistent out of 300 people were not propagating any information. And then, when next day, okay, Planck result were published, it happened that FNL is equal 2.5 plus minus 5.8. Perfect. You see, then it was too late already to cancel conferences, but it's okay also. Everybody is unhappy, I am happy. Because before that, Andrei was calling me and scaring with this FNL and telling that we have to write paper to explain it, but okay. Happens that we don't need to increase the entropy by writing extra paper. So, now, what about NS? Okay, when I wrote to Lyman, after they made also this low-scale Atacama thing, then... Oh, I have the graph. So, this is theoretical predictions, as I said. You can think with one parameter if you are unhappy to have it without any parameter, right? Because optical depth I do not know, and optical depth reflects normalization at L larger than 10, yeah? But doesn't matter. But the rest of the parameters you can fix with... astrophysics, otherwise I don't understand why we pay money for telescopes, right? So now, then this is, yeah, this is good of course, but what I cannot, okay, now it's better. This is map which Planck obtained. So this different color correspond to these tiny fluctuations of the CMB, and from this map you can make Fourier transform and extract the curve which you can compare with the previous curve. It is not cheating, it's real experimental points. Because here you see arrow bar, but why you don't see arrow bar here? Because arrow bars are 4 times smaller than the size of the point. I'm not, also I discovered it accidentally because I was copying one file to the other screen, it became very light, and I was amazed when I have seen this thing. Moreover, these arrow bars is just what people call cosmic variance. So, not enough representative in our universe of this statistical ensemble. So now, the dominating in this arrow bar became cosmic variance, because we have only 2L plus 1 multiple realization within our universe. Systematics is below cosmic variance. Now, when you put now one curve on the other, I think it's marvelous and can be shown in CNN with the title No Comments. Right? And everything is clear. Low L, I do not show here, you know why? I will tell you why. Because, of course, if you are serious, you can be excited, think about some tunneling from one vacuum to the other, but if you are experimentalists know that low L are so much influenced by all these foregrounds about which you do not know. Now they discovered also this dust, etc., etc. Therefore, let's leave low L to experimentalists, and they will learn a lot of astrophysics with them. Because you understand that Planck, besides of cosmology, has a lot of astrophysics. Just nobody pays attention to this thing, because cosmology is something cosmology, and astrophysics is more local thing. No, but two is conditional, okay? So it starts here. Now, moreover, last year, but this year also, you can find, by the way, all these graphs with the title preliminary, because there was 2 conferences on the Planck release. But papers were again postponed, and not because of some kind of contradiction, but because the foreground paper is not yet ready. Yeah? Separation component paper is not yet ready. But already last year, they also presented curve, which is called TE correlation function. Because this fluctuation of background radiation, they are also in addition polarized. And this polarization arises during this 90,000 light years when recombination happens. And at most is generated in the middle of this layer of recombination. This curve depends on the detailed theory of recombination, which is nothing more than atomic physics. Now you take TT curve and from it reproduce parameter, draw this red curve, which is no parameter curve, no parameter at all, and then see all the points there. If you will take last result, okay, which they demonstrate, then showed, then also you understand that they have an addition also E correlation function. The arrow bars are even better. Again, okay, there is a question about cleaning foregrounds and low multipoles, because at low multipoles now optical depth changed, but it doesn't influence large multipole. And by the way, changing of optical depth, making it a little bit smaller, is very good for the people who are doing galaxy formation, because before that there was some kind of contradiction. Now, concerning spectral index, what can we say? People who discovered deviation of spectral index from n equal 1 was WMAP team, yeah? At the beginning, okay, I think first time it was 2006, and then I am getting the result from Lyman that ns is equal 0.95 plus minus 0.04, I guess, yeah? So it was at the level of a little bit more than 3 sigma. You see, Lyman writes me that when he has seen the 0.95, his hand has stand up. He couldn't just believe in it, you see? Now, what happened after that? You see, there was, of course, a lot, besides of WMAP, a lot of so-called ground-based experiment. But you know that if I will go on the previous picture, where it is? WMAP... WMAP was very good in first two peaks, but third peak arrow bars were extremely large. First two peaks allows us to fix omega baryon and omega cold dark matter and also cosmological constant. By the way, the real proof of the existence of cosmological constant was this second Doppler peak. But third one was supposed to give accuracy for NS. People were doing also so-called small-scale experiment like Atacama, then South Pole Telescope, and they got also brilliant result. And some people perhaps will kill me, but I forgot the name of this experiment. Okay, so at large L. But you understand that experiments should have the same normalization if you want to trust to third Doppler peak. But if arrow bars in the region of third Doppler peak are like this one, then you can shift them. Therefore, at a certain point, this number started to slide. And, okay, I really got panicked when it became 0.975. Plus minus better than this thing. At the level of 3 sigma, it was compatible even, I think, with 1, or maybe actually it was South Pole Telescope. But then, again, it was matching of low-scale experiment, low L, and high L experiment. And, of course, final point came from Planck experiment, because, you see, it covers perfectly the things in the region of third Doppler peak, and the thing came in the order. So now... is 0.96 plus minus 0.0007. So it's detection of logarithmic spectra at 6 sigma level. No, 5, okay, let me say, safely say 5. Now, this year, polarization result came. From this kind of curve, you can get practically nothing, because arrow bars there already at the level of cosmic variance, therefore, 2 skies you use, 5 skies, not so much, actually, you learn something more. But now, the result which will be published, and which already were shown, from this kind of curve, I mean TT curve gave here 0.062. But if you will use TT and TE correlation function, then this thing becomes 0.042. Anyway, 9 sigma detection of the logarithmic spectra. You see, 9 sigma, it's even for particle physics a little bit too much, I guess. So, no any doubt, there will be no any, I think, improvement of this result in the nearby future, in spite of the fact that I was expecting that it will go to 0.035 or 0.003. 12 sigma is better than 9, right? But no, you can write, of course, but it doesn't mean anything because here it became 0.965, but you understand that it's within 1 sigma. But now what about gravity wave? So I saw that everything is confirmed. We can sleep well, at least. Quantum perturbations were confirmed. But you understand that if quantum perturbations, which have no alternative whatsoever, yeah, right now, because strings, cosmic strings plus textures were ruled out around 2000 with the discovery of these peaks. Now, by the way, actually, nobody now speaks even about this alternative, but they were there. Now, what happened with this thing? I was sleeping quite well, but one day I was disturbed 3 days before, making big noise, because I got a secret message from a good friend who wrote to me that BICEP discovered 0.2 and plus minus, plus was one plus as a minus, here there was, I guess, minus 0.05, something like this one, yeah? And from Planck, from this curve, which you have there, but I didn't show this multiple, which correspond to 80, 60, because you use Bind multiple, 50 and 30, where points are perfectly still on this curve, okay, it was following bound on R, which was smaller than 0.11, and which was in agreement with WMAP perfectly well. So 0.11 was 95% coincidence level. So look at 0.2. Okay, it's more than 3 sigma away. And if you would add this amount to this perfect curve, what you would see? You would see that, okay, at low multiple, 50, 40, 30, your theoretical curve would go 9% above, okay, for this normalization, which is fixed anyway. So these 3 points would be missing for sure. You see, you can speak about sigma, I believe more my eyes than to sigma, yeah? Then when I see that these points are missing, low multiple problem becomes even worse, then I tell that, okay, it cannot be just the case. Of course, there came immediately people who explained this result in theory. So they took inflation and precisely at multiple 80, screw the spectra. So they said that at multiple 80, for them specially, somebody prepared drop in the power spectra. Therefore, from the very beginning, I said that there are 3 guys, Planck, BICEP, and theory with capital T. Yeah, and the theory, not a theory. And this guy, BICEP and Planck, just do not go together. And one of 3 guys should die. It was clear from the very beginning. It was my prediction number 5, you see. And of course, my prediction was confirmed, because fortunately, BICEP died. Because if Planck would die, then all other prediction would be doubt, as you understand, you see. But BICEP, what one can say? Nothing. Now nobody even discussing this thing anymore. It's also psychological, I think, event. And historian of science, in a couple of years should take care about it and then put it in the same chapter with superluminal neutrino. You see, of course, you should not rush if you are not even sure to New York Times and should not actually do so much noise. And I was telling guys, okay, wait, it's dust. I wrote moral message still before 17. You guys really are sure at the level of 7 sigma? No, it's in fact 2 sigma, but if they put all together, okay, this peak, raising, by the way, which was wrong, then they come to 7 sigma. You see, so it was not quite clear what all this about, and also second thing, they didn't look like this kind of thing. Now, okay, Planck found a lot of dust, even in the cleanest region. Therefore, next question, what we are going to do with gravity wave? Of course, I think that, okay, even if you have 4 predictions, which already are confirmed, which follow from one assumption, quantum fluctuations amplified somehow, yeah? Then it's enough. But you know that if somebody promised you a lot, then if you will get too much, yeah? You will get a lot from him, then you are not completely happy, yeah? So in this sense, if there would be no gravity wave, now nobody would be discussing anything, yeah? But because there is gravity wave, you have to find it. And people will go, and perhaps in space, because there are too high for a ground. But then you could ask the question, why people should go in the space if everything is established, right? Good question. Because there are still, I still have some time for alternatives, in spite of the fact I promised it to Eliezer, who cannot be here, but you perhaps also heard about so-called alternatives. Right? So, what we have established? We have established that we started with quantum fluctuations and nobody doubted anymore, even Rubakov, who has alternative, that quantum fluctuations have no any alternative. All alternatives were kicked out. Then what remains? Little mechanism for amplification of this perturbation. Moreover, in the previous lecture, I think I explained you that if you start amplifying perturbation and expanding universe, then inflation has no alternative. But then what people did, they went to decelerated universe, slow contracting universe, and then they invented the way not to predict the spectra, but to get the same result which were predicted 35 years ago. You see? And then they call that you cannot make homomorphism, yeah, between what we have and the theory. Quantum fluctuations, we agree that they are there, but perhaps they were amplified in contracting universe. And how you do it? Instead of superfast expansion, in contracting universe, you consider super slow contraction, so like duality. The only problem is that, of course, you have to go through the singularity. For a very long time I thought that it's impossible, but recently, unfortunately for myself, I found that even this thing is possible with little modification, including this mimetic matter with potential, yeah? But then, okay, of course, I cannot trust in all these things because in contracting universe people use one component for background and the other component to generate perturbations. Therefore, this theory should be compared rather with this curvaton scenario where you can get everything, but not with this thing, yeah? But there is the other kind of argument which Paul Steinhardt is bringing everywhere, criticizing inflation. And you know, his argument, by the way, Gus and Linda both agreed to me, surprisingly to me, are about this multiverse. And the line of reasoning is very simple. I will tell you. Okay, in 2 words. Normal inflation, okay, predicts that phi is equal epsilon divided by 1 plus W. Now, if you will assume that 1 plus W depends on epsilon, then, okay, if you set this thing to be equal 1, then this equation has always solution for all existing scenario for epsilon, which is called epsilon self-reproduction. What does it mean, this thing? You see, if you will take here time and here energy density in our universe, this, okay, in the scales like h minus 1, will be tracing this thing, then this is Planck density. And normally, epsilon self-reproduction is always below than the Planck density. If you will start here, below self-reproduction scale, then, okay, you go down, energy density goes down smoothly, and quantum fluctuation just slightly disturbs the whole thing. If, nevertheless, this condition is satisfied, so you started somewhere here, then quantum fluctuations become very relevant. And instead of going down, according to the classical equation, field can jump up. So if the guy starts here, that it reminds drunk sailor. Instead of going directly home, it starts to go like this one. Finally, of course, he becomes non-drunk and finally proceeds home. But it looks like the guy has also infinite bottles of alcohol, which he distributes in between. Because this guy is producing exponentially many regions. And finally, if you will consider this kind of scenario, what you will get? You will get infinite universe, which is smooth on our scale, which is inhomogeneous on big scales, and everywhere eternally goes inflation. Now, you know that when you have exponential expansion, then naturally you expect that most of the regions will be just de Sitter space. And if we have a lot of de Sitter space with high probability, we are Boltzmann brains. Then here you are producing a lot of these de Sitter universes. If you merge it with landscape, situation become even worse. And the theory lose predictability, as Steinhardt claimed. Unfortunately for me, both Lind and Goose agreed with him, and they are still okay for 20 years. Look for measure, just with one purpose, not to get absurd, yeah? Because sometimes they are getting, for instance, that probability that our universe is 13 billion years is equal 10 and power minus 10, 54. 50, not 57, 54, yeah? It's so-called Young's paradox. So 20 years looking for resolution of absurd doesn't solve absurd. Of course, all physicists would tell, who cares? Because everything what we need to explain in our data lasts 70 e-folds of inflation. 70, right? Larger than 70. If you want to get self-reproduction, minimal number of e-folds should be 10^6. Now, look at this extrapolation. You see, if you didn't have 10^6 e-fold of inflation, normal inflation, then, okay, you are starting below. But then somebody will come to you and tell that if you start below, then there is small parameter. The ratio of energy below where you started to Planck energy. And then you make some small numbers out of the ratio of these energies, like 3 orders of magnitude below Planck scale, you are making it 10^3. Of course, 10 exponent minus 10^3 is not so bad as 10^3, I guess, yeah, so I forgot already, but nevertheless, not like exponent minus 90, minus 10^90, yeah, but nevertheless, it's also not quite good. This is one of the criticisms. Therefore, it's better to start at Planckian densities, right? And then there is no parameters there. You go down, but on the other side, it looks like, to say about probability, which I, by the way, don't know even how to define. On the other side, it looks like you cannot avoid self-reproduction. Nevertheless, there is good way, and it's practically unique, to avoid self-reproduction. And it's the last sentence which I say, and I found it, I think, when it happened, a few months ago. Look at this thing. How 1 plus W should depend on epsilon, so phi will not become of the order of 1, yeah? Even if you will go to epsilon equal 1. There is practically unique possibility. The 1 plus W epsilon should be proportional to epsilon in power gamma, where gamma is smaller than 1. Then, what you have, you get phi in power proportional energy density in power 1 minus gamma. And it's clear that only when you are at Planck scale, this condition is satisfied. Now, if you will look at this description, how it should be modified, I mean in terms of equation of state, then irrespective of gamma, this modification is unique. You write 1 plus p over epsilon is equal beta over n in power alpha, and that here 1 over 3 gamma, gamma is this gamma, nm minus n. So then when nm, maximal number of efforts, minus n is of the order of 1, you get Planck density. And in this case, equation of state evolves like this one. 1 plus W, okay, goes here down first, and then you raise it like this one. This is practically unique possibility. But in this case, if you claim also that energy density is equal Planckian, you don't need free parameter in the potential because amplitude of perturbation, also phi, can be expressed in terms of maximal number of efforts. It's 1 divided by n maximal divided 1 over 2 gamma. You see, now, you have to have at least 100 efforts on one side. On the other side, you want to decrease, to go down, keeping condition 1 plus W smaller than 1. And then, when you look what kind of potential, when you take and recalculate it on the potential for scalar field, it will be potential which is some potential which was like, if you take m squared, phi squared, etc., etc., multiplied by 1 divided by phi m minus phi. It can be cube here, can be force power, but it cannot be 2 because then you violate slow roll condition. If it's too large, then amplitude of perturbation and duration of inflation are incomparable. You see, if it's too large power. Then now, in such a model, you also see that the things are solved, yeah? In a sense, with amplitude, because it's expressed through the duration of inflation. Of course, there is free parameter. The other modification, I do not know how to do this. And then you start at Planck value. You have inflation, which first starts to approach the things. And then you have no self-reproduction. You have one bubble universe with particular concrete predictions. No any uncertainty, so as Johar said, God creates new world constantly, but this world are topologically disconnected, therefore we don't care about them. Moreover, because here maximal duration of inflation is expressed through the amplitude and parameter of the theory, if today there would be not cosmological constant, but something else, we would have finite duration for our universe. It would recollapse, yeah? And for m, maximal duration of inflation, 10^3, it would recollapse even before the smallest black hole would evaporate. Then we would resolve also information paradox. Okay. So, thank you very much. It's finished. Precisely in time.
We have time for some questions.
Yeah, okay.
We have time for a question or two.
One thing I didn't understand, once you have NS, from your formula, oh, you look that you could get R.
Yes, you get low bound on R.
I know it's not true.
No, it's true if you don't see pathologies, yeah? So, you see, it's actually important thing which I forgot to say for future experiment, because, you see, okay, here is scale, here is the wavelengths of perturbation, yeah? Then, when you have NS, then your spectra is fixed, right? Here. NS is fixed, amplitude is fixed by this observation. But then you know that the amount, low bound on the gravity wave could be like this one, which correspond to Starinsky model or to the other things, but for instance, not to new inflation, because new inflation corresponds to spectral index NS equals 0.94, and it will be even below. But here R is about 0.3%, so two orders of magnitude below what we have. What actually, for instance, m squared phi squared was given us is not very natural thing, because then both contribution from to spectral analysis, there was two contributions, because of change of Hubble constant, because of change of deviation of equation of state. Everything what is natural, okay, is somewhere here. But there are two attractors. One is 0.16, and the other is 50 times less just. Therefore, if people will not see it right now, there is no strategy. Then we introduce with TBO also one parameter, okay, inflation, namely in this equation for V, yeah, there was speed of sound. Speed of sound now cannot be made too small because it produced too large non-Gaussianities, but we can still decrease the things by factor few. You see, therefore, it's difficult actually. Only if people will find a lot of gravity wave with completely wrong spectra, then inflation is ruled out, yeah? In this sense, because although some people found the way how to do it with Galileon or God knows what, yeah. Not Galileo, Galileon, yeah. But okay. So there is actually naturally expected. It's not so rigorous about, but you know that in physics there is nothing rigorous for the level of mathematician, but it's naturally expected value.
Okay, maybe it's a good time for a break. I remind you that after the 15 minutes, we will have a talk by the former head of the Mossad. Let us thank Slava again for a very...